Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
How do you present things before God? See, not only is it important what you offer to God, but how you do it. And that's exactly the message that God wanted to teach the Israelites in this week's study. So take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Hosea and chapter 12. And we're going to see some very strong words of the prophet to the people. Look with me to verse 1, the prophecy of Hosea and chapter 12. We read here, Ephraim sets before me with deceit or falsehood. Now, this is important because God's not focusing on what they're giving, but how he's giving it. And it uses a word here, kachash, which has to do with falseness. That which, another way to understand that, is a denial. Denies the power of God. Now, why is that important? Because it's only when we're living, walking, serving God in his power, are we going to be able to come before him in a way that is pleasing to him. If we come before and offer him something in our strength, with our wisdom, according to our way of thinking, to God is going to be falsehood. It's not going to have the characteristics that he is looking at, those spiritual qualities that only truth can bring about. One of the things that's very important to God is truth. As we've talked about, we can't worship God just in the spirit. It has to be the spirit and truth. Truth empowers things. Truth anoints things for the purposes of God that they might be fulfilled. So he says in this first verse, they put before me with falsehood. Who does? Ephraim. And with deceit, the house of Israel. Now, this second word in the second half of that phrase is mirmah. Mirmah is deceit. And here's what I want you to see. It makes it very clear here that the children of Israel are failing God, not out of an unawareness. See, it's not that, well, they just don't know better or they don't know how to do right. That's not what he's saying. The choice here of this word mirmah in Hebrew speaks to the fact that they're doing something with deceit. It is a cognitive. It is a commitment to something. A commitment to their way rather than his way, and God is not pleased. Now, in the first part of verse 1, he uses the term Ephraim and Israel, that northern kingdom. And as we've talked about, the vast majority of Hosea, this book, has to do with those northern 10 tribes. But now and then, he speaks about the southern kingdom, by the name of Yehuda or Judah or Judea. And here in the second half of verse 1, that's exactly what we see. It says, and Yehuda still rules with God, and with the saints are faithful. Now, does that mean that Judah is perfect, no sin, a great representation of what God wants his people to be? No, that's not what he's saying. What he's saying, though, is this, that Judah has not turned away from the God of Israel. In Judah, and specifically in Jerusalem, that temple is still a place where the Lord God is worshiped. What he says is faithful to the saints, meaning still in Jerusalem, the saints, and who are the saints? They are the ones who want to worship God, serve God. They can still do so in this location. In the northern kingdom, not so. It has been given over to idolatry. Judah still reflects the character of God, a habitation of God. Look on to verse 2. We're going back now to Ephraim, and it says, Ephraim feeds on wind. Now, this word wind is the word ruach. It can also mean spirit. But context tells us if we're talking about the spirit of God, or a ruach hazakah, a strong wind in the natural sense. Sometimes this word ruach can be used not just as wind, but an unclean spirit. And that is what we see in this passage. We see that Ephraim is succumbing to an ungodly, unspiritual, demonic influence. So Ephraim, he feeds on the wind. And when we do that, when we are not being nourished by the Word of God, by truth, by that which is spiritually of God, what's going to happen? Well, it says that he is pursuing Kadim. What's Kadim? It is an eastern wind. But understand what the scripture is saying here. An eastern wind is a wind of judgment. So when we are nourishing ourselves spiritually on that which is empty, that which is devoid of spiritual truth, what are we doing? We are pursuing. Now, someone's not saying, I want God's judgment. I'm going after his judgment. No. But when you are feeding on improper teaching, you are pursuing the judgment of God. That's what he wants the people to realize. Read on in the second half of verse 2. He says, all day long, they multiply falsehood and thievery. Now, these two things go together. Falsehood, lie, deceit, however you want to translate that word, kazav, and thievery. See, I lie that I might profit. I lie that I might deceive and get something from it. And that's the Northern Kingdom. It's not based upon truth. It's not seeking the blessings of God. It's seeking the material things of this world. And oftentimes, this world, it's not fair, it's not just, and it's not operated under the principles of God. See, that's why it talks about how we're sojourners here. As we study in the book of Revelation, we need to remember that we are citizens of the kingdom of God. What does that mean? Not that we live there yet, but it means that we behave as though we do. We don't aren't motivated by how the world thinks, what is necessarily legal here. There's a lot of things which are legal, which are an abomination before God. So what he's saying here is something very, very simple. He's telling us that we need to be motivated by the truth of God's word, not by lies and the desire to steal. Read on in verse 2. What's the problem with Ephraim, this northern kingdom Israel? They have made a covenant with Assyria. Now, this covenant is because of fear. They have made a political agreement with Assyria for protection. And what does that say? That they are a faithless people. Why do I say that? Because when you believe in God, if you love God, what does the Word of God say? Perfect love casts out all fear. You love God perfectly, you're not going to fear your enemies. And when you're walking in obedience with God, the enemy is going to be powerless against you. See, one of the things that the enemy does is that the enemy tries to get you to pay attention to him, to get you to do battle with him. You know how you fight the enemy? By serving God. You just do the things that God has called you to do based upon the revelation of Scripture. That's how you fight the enemy. You don't go after his attacks. You don't go to where he's working. You go to where God is working, and you participate in the things of God. That's what defeats the enemy. When you obey God, it is an invitation for God to defeat that enemy. Well, move on, if you would, to the latter half of verse 3. It talks about the word shemen. Shemen is oil. And in this context, it's speaking about an anointing. And in this context, the anointing is God's provision. And what's happening is this. Israel, because it's not relying upon God, but relying upon man, it's taking the anointing, the preparation, the provision that God provides. And what's doing? Taking them to Egypt, meaning Israel's going to go into exile. These potential that they have, they're forsaking, and they're really empowering the enemy by their behavior. Verse 3. Now in verse 3, there's a change. For the next few verses, we're not going to talk about the northern kingdom. We're going to talk about Judah, the southern kingdom. And we're going to do so by remembering the origin of Judah, that is the kingdom of God, and that is Jacob. Now, let me tell you, Jacob, despite what many people say and teach falsely, Jacob is a good name. His name does not mean deceiver or surplanter. His name means one who follows after. That is one who pursues. And what is he pursuing? Well, think about his history. He was pursuing what? The heritage of God. Why do I say that? Well, let's look at verse 3. It begins by saying, the Lord has a contention with Judah, and he will visit upon Jacob according to his ways. According to his deeds, he will return to him. What's it speaking about? Just that God's faithful. And if God has a contention, he's going to act upon that according to the ways and the deeds of an individual. So Judah is not perfect. But we go back to Jacob. Why? Because Jacob is foundational. And why do I say that? Well, look now to verse 4. We're going to see Yaakov or Jacob's origin. Verse 4. In the womb, he sees his brother. Now, who are we talking about? Jacob and Esau. When they were in the womb, you can go back to the book of Genesis, there was a struggle between them. Based on what? Based upon each of their desire for that birthright. Now, in the flesh, in the strength of human flesh, Esau is powerful. Esau was the one who came out. But Jacob, he didn't give up. Even though he was going out of the womb, that is Esau, we know that, what does it say here? That Jacob sees his brother, wanting to pull him in, but in the flesh, he was not strong enough, but he did not give up. Remember that. Jacob didn't give up. It says, but with power, he wrestled God. Now, this is the same verse, and it's trying to give us a hermeneutical understanding using the context of Scripture for arriving at the proper interpretation. So Jacob wanted this birthright. And eventually, he purchased that birthright. And with the birthright comes the blessing. Now we know, and it's hard for me to believe, how many biblical teachers, when they look at this conflict between Jacob and Esau and the birthright and the blessing, they side with Esau. They make terrible statements about Jacob, and they ought not. Because biblically speaking, Jacob, he, in a fair manner, Nothing underhandedly, he purchased the birthright. With the birthright comes the blessing. He was right when he went before his father and says, I am Esau, because he had the right that Esau was given. But Esau sold to him. But here's the key. He didn't give up. He was pursuing. He was seizing that hill. Hill is synonymous with victory. He wanted victory. And what was that? The privilege of serving God. Now, we look at the end of verse 4. It says, and with his power, he wrestled with God. How did he do that? Verse 5 tells us. He wrestled with that angel, and he prevailed. Now, we need to understand that he was wrestling with the angel of the Lord. But in a sense, it was God's presence who was also there. And he did not give up. Remember? That angel at dawn wanted to return up to the heavens, and he says, release me. Jacob says, I won't do it until you what? Bless me. What was he seeking? A blessing. That's a good thing. And he got that blessing. But how did he get it? Well, notice it says, with weeping and with supplication. And that is associated with a right framework for worship, a right mindset for honoring God. Why do I say that? Look at the end of verse 5. For in God's house, and we're talking about Bethel, that's what it literally says, the house of God, he will find us. Now, it's giving this as an example to you and me. We want God to acknowledge us, find us. We have to be like Jacob. Don't give up. With weeping and supplication, seek God. Why? We want to be used by God. That's what Jacob was about. So he says, he will find us, and there, what will he do? Speak with us. Now, what's he talking about? Giving us revelation. When was the last time you cried? When was the last time, and the word here to supplicate means to entreat, or better yet, to plead or beg. When was the last time you came before God weeping, saying, I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to stop this prayer. I'm not going to go on with my life until, God, you give me your revelation, what you want me to know. That's proper worship. That's what God is seeking in his people. So when we do that, God will speak to us. Verse 6, and the Lord, the God of the heavenly armies, the Lord is his memorial. Now we're talking about Jacob. Jacob trusted in this heavenly God, this God of the heavenly host, the heavenly armies. And he says he is his remembrance. What does that mean? Jacob remembers God. Doesn't matter what the situation might be, what's going on in Jacob's life. He remembers God, and that is sufficient. Just like I said, bad things are happening. The enemy is bigger than you, stronger than you. Remember, God is with you. Remember that God has a purpose, a plan for your life. You don't need to give that enemy, that threat, that problem priority. Just turn to God, seeking his will and a desire not just to know his will, but to carry it out. That's what victory is. Verse 7. Now it talks about repentance, a very key part of repentance. Many people think repentance is what I do to get to God. Not true. Repentance is with God. Why do I say that? Look at verse 7. And you, with your God, repent. So God's there to help us to repent, help us to turn to him. But there is a preconceived thought process that you must have. All repentance has this as a foundational characteristic. Notice what it says. Chesed u'mishpat shmor. Chesed is grace in the Hebrew language. So repentance is seeking God's grace. Not just a grace to be saved. That's important. You probably have already received God's grace to be saved. Hopefully you've invited Messiah Yeshua, that is Jesus Christ, into your life. That you've trusted in this one who laid down his life on that cross, who shed his blood for your redemption, your eternal redemption. So grace here, notice that it's moved and put alongside with what? With mishpat. Now, mishpat is justice. So the grace of God just doesn't save me. That's part of it. That's a great part of it. But the grace of God also works justice in my life and through my life. That's an important truth. The grace of God works justice in my life, but through my life. It's just like the prophet Zechariah says. Zechariah says, execute justice. That's what God's people do. You find a situation where there's not justice, get involved in it to make justice. That's how the grace of God works in a person's life. That's what you're supposed to keep. That's what you're supposed to be given over to. And then it says that you can have something. You can have hope in the Lord your God when always. Doesn't matter the situations. If you are concerned by justice, hope in God always. Because he's going to be there to assist you, to provide that justice in your situation. Look on to verse 8. Now, in verse 8, we have the term Canaan. There are three definitions, meanings, terms for this word Canaan. And the root Canaan means to submit. You can submit to the right thing or you can submit to the wrong thing. So Canaan, submission. Another way that the word Canaan is used is for a geographical location in Israel, the land of Canaan or the Canaanites, the people who were called to submit to the things of God. The third way, and this is the way here, that the word Canaan is being used is simply a merchant. It can be a faithful merchant or a not faithful merchant. Unfortunately, in this case, we see that this merchant is not faithful. Notice what he says. A merchant, for in his hand are scales. Now, these scales or balances are important for a merchant. That's how you determine the price of something, what to pay for it. You put the silver on and the weight tells you the price, the value of money. But the problem here is that his scales are what? His scales are mirmah. What's mirmah? Deceitful. Why are they? Because he loves to oppress. Now, if we're spiritually sound, if we're walking in truth, if we're concerned about justice, that is, if the grace of God is functioning in our life, we are going to be people of integrity. We're going to walk in truth. Not so here. The problem with Ephraim, that northern kingdom, is that they're motivated by profit, even an unrighteous, a wrong-gotten profit. So it says here, he loves to oppress. Who's this? Ephraim. Look at verse 9. And Ephraim says, I have become wealthy. I have found my power. Now think of that. He did not say, God has blessed me. He says, I have become wealthy. How? What's the context? By cheating others. He says, I found my power. And if you pay close attention, he says, and in all my efforts, you won't find any iniquity, anything that contains sin. That's what he's saying. That's a proclamation that's false. Why do we know that? We'll move on to the next verse, verse 10. For I, the Lord your God. Now he's speaking about who he is. And then he says, May Eretz Mitzrayim, from the land of Egypt. Whenever we have that phrase, from the land of Egypt, it's speaking about the Exodus. And why were the people in Egypt to begin with? Sin. So God says, hey, don't fool me. You can't lie to me. You were in Egypt. What got you there? Sin. So Ephraim is not this perfect one, this self-made man, this one who has become a millionaire because of his righteousness and there's no sin in his action. God says, you can't lie to me. I'm the one that brought you out of Egypt, where you were there because you sold your brother Joseph unrighteously in sin to the Midianites. Verse 10, he says, but despite this, he says, I will cause you to dwell in tents as in the days of the appointed times. Now, what God is saying is this, that he is able to take Ephraim, one who does not know the truth or not least living the truth, not proclaiming the truth. God says, you know what? I am going to bring you back to a point where you once more are like the days of the appointed time. What is that? Worshiping me. Now, why is that verse there to tell us that above all things, God wants to show us that repentance leads us to what? Leads us to worship him. Move on to verse 11. Here we're talking about prophets and the importance of prophecy. He says, and I will speak concerning prophecies. I will multiply vision. Now, it's interesting. He talks about prophets in the plural, but here he's talking about visions. I will multiply, not visions, but vision. Meaning God is going to say the same thing. He's going to give that same vision over and over and over. God is not man that he changes his way. And this prophecy is so important. He says, in the hands of the prophets, what they said, he says, I will what? I will be likened, or I will be, the implication is that God is going to make himself known through prophecy. And that's why we're studying prophecy. You may say, you know, it's not that exciting. I think it is, but you may not. You may not see all the principles. You may not get excited with this, but understand one thing. It is through prophecy that you can know what God is like. You can find his character, this testimony of God, through these words. And that's why, and we talked about this in our study of Revelation chapter 19 and verse 10, where it says, the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Yeshua. That is, we can know who the Messiah is, what he's done, what he is doing, and what he's going to do by understanding prophecy. So never be negligent of the prophets. So he says, in the hands of the prophets, I will be like, and you will know what I'm like. Verse 12, he says, if in Gilead there's unrighteousness, it was for vanity. Now, in Gilead, where is that? Gilead is west of what? Gilead, should say east of the Jordan River. It's not in the Israel today. It's east of that. It's in Jordan. And what do we know about that? Well, that's the land that Reuben and Gad, those two tribes with the half tribe of Manasseh, wanted to be. Now, here's what he's saying. They chose that land, and they probably had some selfish motivation. That is vain. They saw that as good land for their cattle, and they had a worldly motivation. That's vanity. But that is pale in comparison. That's what he's trying to say here. It is slight compared to what took place in Gilgal. Gilgal is where God moved to renew his covenant relationship with them, where Passover was once again celebrated. But it became soon thereafter a place of idolatry, a place where oxen were sacrificed. Also, there was many altars, how much like a waves of altars upon the fields. And what he's trying to say here is, once again, they made all these altars in all these fields in order that there would be a prosperous harvest. Well, God promises that. But they turned to pagans for that. They turned to false gods for that, rather than believing God for his promises. Verse 13, and Jacob, he fled to the field of Aram. Now, what are we talking about here? Well, this is when Jacob left the land of Israel, went to Aram, and what did he do? He got married, it says. And there in the field of Aram, Israel served. He served for a woman. And it says, with a woman, he kept. Now, what does that mean? He kept the promises of God. He kept that covenant because God told him, Jacob, in your seed. And because of that, he wanted a wife to produce a seed, because with that seed comes blessing. And that's why we need to understand this principle of prophecy. He says, and with a prophet, the Lord brought up the children of Israel from Egypt. And with a prophet, they're going to be kept. So it's only through prophecy that we're going to be kept in the things of God, so that we can live the purposes of God and reveal the glory of God to those who are lost. Well, once again, my time has run out. Until our next session, may God richly bless you.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.